Welcome to this short executive knowledge lecture on topic 4, paper 12 of the SFC licensing exams. This topic covers the investment management process. And as you can see on the screen, this involves looking at, first of all, an overview of the process, and then getting into some of the detail. We'll be considering setting investment objectives, formulating an investment strategy, asset allocation strategies, varying from strategic asset allocation to tactical asset allocation, while considering passive and active asset allocation strategies, investment management styles. We'll then look at performance measurement and evaluation. That's where some of the number crunching will come in. Then we'll review the monitoring of the investment management process. And finally, we'll consider the role of the fund research house or the rating agency. Now, I will emphasize the important points to help you understand the core material you need to know to sit the exam. And as ever, a copy of the study notes you see on the screen can be downloaded from the Executive Knowledge website under Paper 12 Resources. I strongly recommend, once again, that you supplement this learning with question practice that is provided on the website examinator.online, as it's through practicing questions, getting them wrong, understanding why you got them wrong, that you will build up your short-term memory in preparation for the exam. Okay, let's start off with the overview of the investment management process. And the investment management cycle is structured as the way you can see on page 4.3. We start off with defining the investment objectives, of which there are two: return requirements and risk tolerance. And we also need to be aware of the constraints to the investment strategy, the constraints being liquidity, investment horizon, tax considerations, legal restrictions, and the unique preferences and needs of the fund and the client. You then set the investment strategy, which leads to implementing and managing a portfolio. And consistently, you will monitor and review the portfolio, its makeup, its performance, and you may well go back and redefine investment objectives, constraints, and so it continues. So what do we do when setting investment objectives? Well, first of all, we have to identify them and the constraints, and they should reflect those of the underlying investors. Now, a fund's objectives, before we get there, need to take into account the constraints that I briefly outlined a moment ago. More specifically, cash flows, forecasts are required for redemptions or purchasing, selling securities. Now, this is with regard to a fund itself. So a fund must have enough cash to be able to deal with redemptions as they come in. What will the liabilities of the fund be, including dividends, fee payments to trustees, advisors? What are the legal requirements? Now, please be aware that a major requirement for fund managers in Hong Kong is compliance with the Code on Unit Trusts and Mutual Funds. Now, that's dealt with in Paper 6. We don't have to worry about the detail in there, but we should be aware that trustees of funds must adhere to the explicit duties as set out in that code and indeed in the underlying legislation. The investment horizon of a fund is important. Is it short term? Is it long term? What are the tax considerations? What are the tax going to be payable on the fund's asset? And downside risk. Fund managers should understand maximum loss that investors, clients will tolerate. Now, what about the objectives of a fund? Now, these they should reflect the objectives of the underlying investors. But the fund will put forward its own objectives so that potential investors understand and see if they can align their objectives with those of a particular fund. And they can be along the lines of outperforming inflation or cash deposit rates by a certain percentage, outperforming a relevant benchmark over a specific period of time, for example, outperform the Hang Seng Index by 2% over a five-year period. Now, these are potential objectives. Now, a very important document in the whole investment process is the investment policy statement. And that sets out the goals, describes strategies to meet the objectives set. The major sections of an investment policy statement, statement of purpose or overview, the investment objectives, some of which we considered a moment ago, roles and responsibilities of the investment manager, and investment guidelines and boundaries. Now, why do we need an investment policy statement? This could easily be a question in the exam. Well, the reason it's important to state goals of the investment plan, provide a benchmark and an evaluation system for performance, to set boundaries for strategies and products, and to provide clear communication, better understanding of the investment policy. So that if things go awry, if there is grand volatility in the market, if people are caught off guard, we go back to the investment policy statement, which tells us how we should be proceeding. Proceeding in times of uncertainty and volatility. Formulating the investment strategy, section three. Well, we need to match the investment objectives with the investment manager's skills. And when you are selecting a fund manager, research can be published from a fund research house or ratings agency. And that we actually deal with right at the end of this topic. Now, when a client's investment strategy is confirmed, either a specialist or discretionary manager will be appointed. It can be a combination of both. And the two approaches to implementing strategic asset allocation of portfolio funds are indeed discretionary and specialist. So what's the difference? Well, with the discretionary approach, the trustee or client authorizes a fund manager to make and implement asset allocation decisions. So it's the trustee or the client who says what the strategic asset allocation is going to be. Fund manager may have to rebalance portfolio from time to time to remain with that strategic asset allocation. Now, as we'll see, strategic asset allocation is the allocation in the broad categories, equities, bonds, cash, etc. Specialist approach, trustee or client decides the asset allocation. So the first one, the trustee or client authorizes the fund manager. Through that, there is discretion. Whereas the specialist approach is the trustee or the client knows what they want and they are able to decide the asset allocation. Asset modeling. Well, to ensure the investment objectives constraints are realistic, asset models can be constructed, often spreadsheets, putting in a series of assumptions and running some numbers to see what the outcomes would be. Asset models are highly relevant when some investment objectives are conflicting. So protecting capital while growing capital, it's very difficult to do both. So by running some asset models, it can be clear to clients what is and is not achievable. When a fund has actuarial liabilities to meet, life assurance, for example, asset liability model should also be built to test various investment strategies. And we'll be looking at the liability method later. Both types of models mathematically estimate the risk of not achieving particular investment objectives. So you run the numbers and you can work out what you're trying to do is in fact achievable. The fund manager can use sensitivity analysis to test the asset models. And generally, asset models and asset liability models should be interpreted with caution. They are not certain by any means. Now, is the investment manager taking an active or passive approach? Now, these are two very broad categories of investment that I'm sure you've heard of, you're aware of. Let's just look at what the notes tell us. Passive managers generally view markets as efficient, believe they cannot consistently outperform the market net of fees. In other words, they'll just sit back, allocate the capital and wait. And hopefully the market will be kind and positive Most important objective for passive managers, minimize tracking error. Now, tracking error we cover right at the end. Passive investment management can be implemented in-house, or you can outsource it to a manager that will not take any risky bets. Passive managers are far more conservative. On the other hand, active managers believe that the market does not fully reflect true value. They believe there's alpha out there, and we'll cover that later, creating opportunities to produce excess returns. Now, a passive manager does not believe excess returns are possible. Active managers do. Active managers aim to outperform a particular benchmark. However, we're told empirical evidence shows, on average, they are not very successful. So some active managers are successful. Some of the sort of celebrity investors you may have heard about, lots have been written. But on average, active managers find it difficult to outperform benchmarks. Now, with both passive and active management, portfolio balancing will occur to maintain the original strategic asset allocation weightings. And remember, that's the weightings among equities, bonds, cash, maybe alternative assets, the broad weightings of an investment portfolio. Now we consider asset allocation strategies, and we'll go through a number of them. We've referred in general to passive and active. Now we're going into a little bit more detail. Strategic asset allocation, as I've been discussing, is portfolio management using a constant set of asset weights based on longer-term investment policy. Now, unlike active asset allocation, where you're changing all the time, strategic asset allocation requires less frequent changes in the portfolio, rebalancing assets back to the benchmark, and lower transaction costs. This is very easily examined. You can write a very simple question, just seeing if you can appreciate what is involved with strategic asset allocation. It adopts a top-down approach, weighting funds between fixed income, securities, equities, before choosing the individual securities. So you're going for the broad percentages, and then you go into the detailed security selection. Strategic asset allocation often implemented under a set of predetermined ranges. For example, and the table shows you some ranges for a conservative fund. Cash between 5 and 20%. Fixed income, the largest component, between 55 and 85%. And equities, more risky, between 10 to 35%. Now, when setting the approved ranges, you should consider ranges that are too narrow can be very constraining, so don't make the ranges too narrow. Ranges that are too broad, on the other hand, can increase short-term volatility, and measure of the fund's net exposure to each asset class should be considered. So that's strategic asset allocation. What about passive asset allocation using indexing? Passive approach using index funds assumes that the fund manager cannot consistently outperform benchmark. Now, we discussed that a moment ago. Most of these types of funds utilize passive asset allocation in its purest form. So they make sure that the weightings of the fund are reflect the weightings of the individual investments in the index. Index fund management will use a sample portfolio that reflects an index. And we're told that, once again, empirical evidence shows that on average, fund managers cannot beat the market. This is something we're being told again and again. Passive fund managers argue that passive funds are more commercially viable because, right, here we go, answers to a question. Why are passive funds more commercially viable? Because of lower fees. They're not as active, so not as costly. Less frequent trading, therefore lower transaction costs, and less risk of underperformance relative to an index, because you're mirroring that index in your investments. Moving on to active asset allocation. Now, this is where you're trying to beat the market, aims to achieve a greater return than if the assets were to remain in the benchmark weightings. Process of planning and implementing the optimal asset mix for a fund at a given point in time to maximize opportunities that are out there. Now, it involves much more short-term decision making and attempts to exploit market mispricing. Now, how can market mispricing arise? Well, it can be from a number of factors, and we list some here. Again, this is the sort of thing they like to examine. Uncertainty about future growth. People are just not sure, and maybe they're inaccurately pricing equities or investments as a result. Inflation. Inflation can cause problems to future performance. Interest rate policy of a government, nowadays usually central banks. Fiscal policy, taxation, government spending. Exchange rates, there's a great deal of uncertainty on exchange rates, how they're going to be moved, given so many are flexible, they're not fixed, they're floating. Now, how does economic factors affect asset allocation? Well, they can affect financial markets and in turn, expected returns of asset classes. So as the economic factors change, maybe equities become more attractive than fixed income bonds. Economic growth particularly can influence the outlook for equity and property returns. So if we expect economic growth to increase in the near future, then you may well move into equities rather than bonds. And inflation prospects, they have a significant impact on the fixed income asset class. As inflation rises, long-term fixed income securities will lose purchasing power. Please be aware of that. So if inflation is rising, then fixed income securities are not as attractive because their purchasing power starts to reduce. And that's something that examiners may more and more look to examine.